Hello everyone. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss an indirect method for generating frequency modulated wave. We have already seen in the previous lectures that FM waves can be generated either by the direct method or by using indirect methods. And in direct methods, we've already studied the reactance modulator circuit for generating FM and the varactor diode modulator for generating FM. Now in direct method, one limitation that we have in the direct method is that it uses an LC oscillator as its master oscillator. And we know that LC oscillators, they are susceptible to frequency drifts. So for circuits using these LC oscillators, it is required to have some additional circuitry like the automatic frequency control circuit in order to take care of this drifts that happen in the FM modulated wave. So for commercial FM transmitters, it is always desirable to go for indirect technique of FM generation. So in this session, we'll be discussing the Armstrong method for generating FM modulated wave, which is an indirect method for generating FM modulated wave. Now, this is the basic principle behind generating FM modulated wave by indirect method. That is, what we do here is we use a phase modulator for generating FM modulated signals. So in the previous session, we have seen how FM and PM are related. That is, we have derived the equivalence between FM and PM. And we've seen that in PM modulated wave, the output of a PM modulator contains FM signals. So we have seen how you can generate FM by using PM. And what we do there is, rather than giving the input signals directly to the phase modulator, if we give a modulating signal through an integrator and then to the phase modulator, you can find that the output what you obtain from the phase modulator is an FM output. So this is actually the indirect technique that we are using in the case of an Armstrong method for generating FM. Now this is the block diagram for the Armstrong method for generating FM. So as I've said, this is an indirect method for generating FM and we're using a phase modulation. That is, phase modulation is used for generating a frequency modulated wave in this particular technique. So these blocks which is shown in this green box, all these blocks in this box shown over here, these blocks are responsible for generating the phase modulated output. So we shall explain this whole block diagram as two stages. First, we'll show that this blocks what we have over here is performing the function of phase modulation, and then we shall see the explanation of the remaining blocks. So in this block, we find that we have a balanced modulator, a phase shifter, 90 degree phase shifter, crystal oscillator, and a combining network. So we shall see first as how these blocks together generate a phase modulated wave. So in phase modulation, phase of the carrier wave varies with respect to the instantaneous amplitude of the modulating signal. So for the time being, we'll not just ignore this equalizer. We'll assume that we have this modulating signal coming as the input to this balanced modulator. So we'll just see the blocks over here. Now you have a balanced modulator which has got one input is the modulating signal. We are ignoring this block for the time being. One input is the modulating signal. The other input is the 90 degree phase shifted carrier signal. So here you have the carrier signal generated by a crystal oscillator. And this carrier signals are phase shifted by just going through a buffer. They are phase shifted by 90 degree. And then you're giving it to the balanced modulator. The two inputs are the carrier signal and the modulating signal. The output of the balanced modulator, we know that the output of a balanced modulator is double sideband suppressed carrier. This output is given to an adder or a combining network. The combining network has got two inputs. One is this DSB SC signal is one input. The other input is a carrier signal. So you have to remember that for the balanced modulator, we're giving the modulating signal and 90 degree phase shifted carrier. To the combining network, the inputs are DSB SC and the output from the crystal oscillator. So the advantage that we have in the indirect method, why we say that the Armstrong method or the indirect method is more stable, produces more stable FM, is that we are able to use a crystal oscillator for generating the carrier signals. So that is the advantage that we have in the case of indirect method, and that is the reason why indirect method is preferred over the direct methods in commercial FM transmitters. Now what we'll see is we shall look into the phasor diagram, and then we'll see over here that the output what comes from the combining network is a phase modulated output. Now this is a phasor diagram. We'll use this phasor diagram to explain how the block shown in that green box is performing the function of frequency modulation. Now in frequency modulation, we know that in phase modulation, we're going to show how that blocks after the output of the combining network is going to be a phase modulated output. So for showing that, we shall use this phasor diagram for explanation. In phase modulation, we find that the phase angle of the carrier changes with respect to the instantaneous amplitude of the modulating signal. So we're just trying to show over here that the output of the combining network or the adder is a phase modulated output. So for that, see over here. Now this, what is shown in blue color over here, is a carrier signal. So we have a carrier signal generated by the crystal oscillator, and its peak, we have shown the vector, we have shown here VC is the strength of that carrier, and it is shown as 0 degree phase angle, phase difference. Or you are showing this is the carrier without any phase shift. This is the carrier shown in blue without any phase shift. Now to the balance modulator, we are giving two inputs. One input is a modulating signal and the other input is a carrier phase shifted by 90 degrees. So this is a carrier with 0 degree phase shift. Now this shown in red, like you can see, this can be considered as a carrier with 90 degree phase shift. So if you're giving this 90 degree phase shifted carrier and your modulating signal as an input to the balance modulator, we'll find that the balance modulator will give a double sideband suppressed carrier output. It's going to give you two sidebands, an upper sideband and a lower sideband. So the phasor for the sidebands are shown over here. This one is one vector, shows one of the sidebands, this shows this other sideband. And we know that the strength of the sidebands, a DSB-SC signal is giving a double sideband suppressed carrier, it's an AM out, and you know that the strength of the sideband is given by M into VC by 2, where M is the modulation index of AM. So here we find that this strength depends on the modulation index, because VC is constant, M depends on modulation index, and modulation index depends on the strength of the modulating signal, because M is equal to VM by VC. As the modulating signal strength increases, you'll find that this vector length increases. As the strength decreases, you find that this vector length decreases. So what you can see over here is these two sidebands are the output of double sideband suppressed carrier. So this carrier is also suppressed. You will not have this carrier as at the output of DSB-SC signal. Now if you take the resultant of these two vectors, you sum up these two vectors, take the resultant vector, you find that the resultant vector is going to be in phase with this. So the resultant vector is going to take this particular phase. This red line will show the resultant vector, and the length of the resultant vector will depend on the length of the sideband vectors for the sideband. So here this is the resultant vector. If suppose this, what we have shown, are the sidebands for a particular case, we'll find that this is a resultant vector for the, or this is the sum resultant for the sideband, sum of the sideband frequency phases. Now we are giving this to the combining network. So combining network, what we have seen is that we are giving, one is a carrier signal without any phase shift, and DSB-SC signal is given as an input to the combining network. Now these two vectors are added, and what we have is a resultant vector, which is the phase. This resultant vector is our output vector, the resultant. Now this resultant vector is actually giving you the phase modulation. Now as the size here, you can find that this angle theta t is the phase angle. Now as the length of this sum of some sideband frequency phases, this length keeps on varying. Now when this is a length, you find the angle is theta t. When the length is this, for example over here, when the length is this, you find that the angle is only theta 1. So as this length varies, you find that this resultant vector also varies, and this angle theta varies. So this is how you can say that by using a balance modulator, and a combining network, a balanced modulator, a phase shifter, crystal oscillator, and a combining network, it is possible to generate a phase modulated output. So you can generate a phase modulated output by this method. So please just see over here, this is a double sideband suppressed carrier output, so you do not have this carrier over here. Now what we have shown in over here in red is the sum of this side frequency phases, and the resultant vector is the output of your combining network or the adder network, and you find that phase modulation is occurring. So this is just to show that this, the first portion what we have shown, is actually doing phase modulation. Now coming back to our block diagram, we have shown that this portion is responsible for generating a phase modulated output, provided that the input we give to the balance modulator over here is just the modulating signal. Now what we're going to show is, initially we have said that you can use a phase modulator for generating a frequency modulated output. Now we are interested in generating frequency modulated output. So now how do you make a phase modulator generate a frequency modulated output? What you do there is, you have to first, your input modulating signal, before you feed into your balance modulator, you have to first integrate that and then give it to your balance modulator. So here you're using a circuit called as an audio equalizer. It is nothing else but your integrator. So your input signal or the modulating signal or your message signal, you integrate it and then give it to your balance modulator, and you can find that the output what you opt in over here is a frequency modulated output. Now the next thing what we're going to see is that you find that this is not the end of the transmitter. You have few more blocks over here. So what you get over here at the output is a narrow band FM, because you know it is like you're getting a frequency modulated wave, but you know that you've got only two sidebands, just one upper sideband and lower sideband. And in FM, we know that we've got a number of sidebands depending on the modulation index. So here we are having modulation index less than one, and then we find that the sidebands over here, only two sidebands are there. So narrowband FM has got a wide range of applications. You can use for mobile communication, you can use in various marine applications for communication, etc. But it, when it goes to some high fidelity application or for broadcast transmissions, it is essential that we have wide band FM. That is, you'll be having more number of sidebands, larger deviation, frequency deviation. So the remaining blocks, what you see over here, are used to raise your frequency to the desired frequency of transmission. For commercial transmit, suppose you have 91.9 megahertz is the channel frequency, or another station frequency can be 104 megahertz. So in order to raise the output signal to the corresponding station frequency, we go for the remaining blocks over here. So the remaining blocks over here are responsible for raising the input signal and input deviation to the required value specified for a particular station. So what we have now, the reason why we go for this narrowband FM is that we have mentioned here we are using crystal oscillators for generating FM modulated wave. Now crystal oscillators, you can find crystal oscillators varying from very low frequency, that is, you can have frequencies ranges from very low to very high frequency ranges, but many a times you find that the stability, though we say that crystal oscillators are very stable, they are stable, but stability is also related, in some way it is related to the frequency ranges also. So it is always desirable to go for crystal oscillators of a lower frequency range. It's supposed to be very stable, and the required frequency, what we require for a particular transmitter, what is usually done is we generate an FM modulated wave, and then we will raise the frequency, or we'll do frequency translation by using one or two stages of multipliers, and then we amplify a signal and then give it for transmission. So it is that what we generate by this indirect method, first is a narrowband FM. We use a group of multipliers, and then we again have a mixer section, again followed by a group of multipliers. Then we, once your signal is ready with the frequency that we require for transmission, we again do the amplification, power amplification stages, followed by that we go for transmitting our signal. Now this blocks over here, this is actually showing you how you can make a wideband frequency modulated wave from a narrowband frequency modulated wave. So here what we use is our frequency multipliers and mixer circuits. So just for example, they've shown here, you have an input signal of 200 kilohertz is a frequency, and the frequency deviation is 25 hertz. So that's FC1 and delta F1. Now we pass it through a frequency multiplier, which is multiplying the input frequency by 64 times, and then we get the output something like 12.8 megahertz, 1.6 kilohertz. Now you can do this frequency multiplication one or two times, or you can have a number of stages for multiplying the frequency to bring up the frequency to the level that you desire. Now, at times that you find that you may require frequencies like 93.4, or you may require like 91.9. So to get these exact frequencies, frequency multiplication alone will not be sufficient. So that is where we go for mixer circuits also. So there again, please remember that we use crystal oscillators only, and we use crystal oscillators as the as for generating oscillations for the mixers. Now here this mixer will generate some and difference frequencies. Since we are interested in frequency translation, bringing up the frequency to a higher level, we'll be opting for the sum frequency. We'll be selecting the sum frequency at the output. So these frequency converters allow us to actually generate the exact required frequency, and then frequency multipliers help us to increase the frequency to the required range. So by these stages or consecutive stages of multipliers and mixers, it is possible to generate a wideband FM from a narrowband FM. And here you can find that from this 200 kilohertz, by using these stages, we've been able to generate 91.2 megahertz. Similarly, the frequency deviation has been increased to 76 kilohertz. Or this is just an example. Usually we say 75 kilohertz is the maximum permissible value frequency deviation in FM. So here what we can see is that as the frequency deviation increases, we know that the frequency deviation is related to the modulation index. So modulation index increases, and in FM we know that the modulation index will determine the number of sidebands with significant amplitudes. So as modulation index increases, we'll find that there are more number of sidebands with significant amplitudes, or you find that the bandwidth is large. So this is how you generate a wide band FM from a narrow band FM. So to summarize, in this session, what we have seen is we have explained the working of the indirect method for generating an FM modulated wave. We have explained here the Armstrong method for generating FM, and we know that in the Armstrong method, phase modulation is done to generate an FM modulated wave, and we have already learned how FM and PM are related, so that case is easy. Now here in the block diagram for Armstrong method, we have seen that we're using a balanced modulator, a phase shifter, crystal oscillator, and a combining network to produce frequency phase modulation. So this phase modulation, how it produces phase modulation, has been explained by using phasor diagram. And then we know that what we generate as the output of this combining network is a narrow band FM, but for commercial purposes or for high fidelity applications, it is essential that we go for wideband FM. So we know that by using a group of multipliers and mixer circuits, it is possible to produce wideband FM from narrowband FM. So this is a method by which we generate FM waves indirectly. So Armstrong method is one method which is commonly used, or a method which is widely accepted for generating FM waves by using this method of phase modulation, or indirect method for generating FM modulated wave. Okay, thank you.